Ham Radio Now, episode 187, Accidental Company, the Making of Flex Radio. This program features Gerald Youngblood, K5SDR. Gerald is the founder and CEO of Flex Radio Systems, and it is from the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference, the DCC, back in Austin, Texas, in 2014, last September, from where I sit right now. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and a message for you flexers. Welcome, flexers. I know you all gather around and bump up the view counts whenever I do a program on Flex Radio. I have a message for you. Hams do not live by flex alone. Go watch some of the other Ham Radio Now videos. All right, what have I got here? Yeah, this is the Saturday Night Banquet Talk from the DCC. The Saturday Night Banquet Talk is usually less technical, sometimes not technical at all, because families typically gather for the banquet. And take a look at this picture here from the editor. That's Gerald there in the background. That is the group. I don't see a lot of families. And Gerald does get a little technical in this talk, not very technical, just enough to be able to really explain how he put Flex Radio together. This is the last and the 19th of 19 programs that have come from this DCC. So there's 18 others from this DCC. The others are mostly very, very technical. And I've got a YouTube playlist. I've always felt bad about how poorly I've organized the DCC talks. So I now have a YouTube playlist that has a total of 83 programs on it. Let's take a look. This is the Ham Radio Now website, hamradionow.tv. And here's one way to get to the playlist. It's sitting right here at this link. And so we'll open it up in a new tab and see what that looks like. So this is the playlist, and I've got them sorted in order, chronological order of when I put them online. So we can see, first of all, from this DCC, and then the numbers take a big jump down, and we see past DCCs. I do have two DCCs worth of programs that are not online yet, 2008 and 2009. Those are the ones that I sold on DVD. I got a couple of individual programs out of them, like the Mercury Receiver series, but mostly they're not online yet. As I get time, I'll take some time to put them online. The DCCs were funded by Kickstarters, and I want to show you the Kickstarter. I did a Kickstarter last year, and won, well, in 2013, and then last year in 2014. Last year's, the goal was $8,000. It brought in a total of $8,675. Now, Kickstarter and the credit card companies all take a little cut of that, so I ended up with a little under $8,000 for my end of that. In that DCC, there were 114 backers. And of those 114, 108 of them were individual backers that started anywhere from $10, 28 backers. Let's see, I had a $25 level, a $50 level, a $100 level, and a $150 level. So those are all the individual backers. And then I had what I call the corporate underwriter level, $500. And we had six backers doing that. That's what added up to the total of $8,000. I'm going to give an abbreviated acknowledgement of the corporate underwriters. I promised them all a specific acknowledgement or mention in all of the programs. And I spent a lot of time talking about them in all the previous programs. So I'm going to make that a little bit quicker here on this one. So the first one is Adam Curry. Adam is KF5SLN. He is the host of the No Agenda Show podcast. And the podcast features politics, media, entertainment. It is not ham radio, not one of those little ham radio podcasts. Adam and his co-host, John C. Dvorak, are on the air live on Sundays and Thursdays. And you can stream them at noagendashow.com. We are also brought to you by TAPR. TAPR is the DCC sponsor, of course. If you're interested in anything digital in amateur radio, hardware, software, data, voice, television, you'll be at home at TAPR. Stop by their website, tapr.org and check them out. We are also brought to you by several hams who encourage you to look into hackersforcharity.org. At Hackers for Charity, you can volunteer your computer equipment and your skills to help out people around the world who really need you but can't begin to afford you, or what they say there. Solving technology challenges for various nonprofits, providing food equipment, job training, and computer education to the world's poorest citizens. Check them out at hackersforcharity.org. And we're also brought to you by the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force. They are at aretf.org. They are a new organization, and their goal is to help provide network standards that are hard to find in ham radio. So they were started last year to help draft and make those standards available. You can get in on the ground floor by stopping at aretf.org. And finally, we are brought to you by an enthusiastic ham who is a supporter of Ham Radio Now and Tapper, who wishes to remain anonymous. He's a regular attendee of the DCC for over 30 years, and he is very enthusiastic about what the DCC and Ham Radio Now are able to do together. So thanks to all the corporate contributors, all the individual contributors. And if you didn't get in on the Kickstarter and you do want to help support Ham Radio Now, that guy is your key. Our chief financial officer, Arvin, the little piggy bank over my shoulder. Stop by hamradionow.tv, click on his icon, and you can go to our support page. Any contributions are welcome, whatever you think the programs are worth to you. So thank you very much. So that is it. This is our last visit to the DCC in Austin, Texas. We have learned a lot. Now it is time to relax. So Steve Bible, N7HPR, Tapper President and DCC Coordinator, take it away.
So I hope everybody leaves the DCC another 10 pounds heavier. Yep, I think there's plenty of calories to go around. If you've not had enough calories, there is the bar in the back of the room. Okay, so it's a little more concentrated and probably a little more fun on that. Okay, so let's segue into our evening guest. I'd like to introduce to you Gerald Youngblood. Gerald Youngblood founded Flex Radio Systems in April 2003 to develop and market the industry's first software-defined radio products to the amateur radio market. As president and CEO, Gerald is responsible for managing the day-to-day operations of the company. Prior to Flex Radio Systems, he founded and ran five technology companies spanning hardware, software, and electronic manufacturing, one of which he took public in 1996. He has been a ham since 1976 as WA5RXV, KE5OH, AC5OG, and now holds an extra class license as K5SDR. Gerald received his BSEE degree from Mississippi State University. So you're an Ole Miss. Nope, that's a different one. Okay, never mind. I goofed that one up. All right. Erase that one. Zip. All right. He is a member of the ARRL Software Defined Radio Working Group and a recipient of the ARRL 2002 Doug DeMaul W1FB Technical Excellence Award and Central States VHF Society 2004 John T. Chambers Award. So let's give a big round of applause to Gerald.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me okay? Yeah. You knocked 10 years off of my ham license. It was 67 instead of 76, so I've got a little longer than that. When Mel invited me, he sent me an email a couple weeks ago and asked me to come talk about the history of Flex Radio. And I thought about, well, that's 15 years if you count when I actually started working on this. And if I have 45 minutes, I think that's about 3 minutes per year. So we're going to have to go pretty quickly through this tonight. There are a lot of different ways that I could take this talk. I could talk about just pure history. I could talk about people. I could talk about products. I could talk about technology. I could talk about business. And so I was talking to Ed over here, Ed Gonzalez, who spoke to you earlier today, and one of the other guys, Abed, and I said, what would you like to hear about if you're sitting in the audience? And he said, I'd like to hear what the crises that occurred and how you dealt with them. Was that the way you put it? So that's what I'm going to talk about. What are the, every business goes through critical points in its lifetime that you could call a crisis. If you're in business for yourself, you sure know what I'm talking about. And so I'm going to do a little bit of that. I'm going to go through the history, but I'm going to talk about some of the things that happened and how they felt at the time. Now, let me just start with saying it's fun to be a pioneer, isn't it? Now, we didn't invent SDR. I can't claim that. SDR was around when I started playing with it. But we were pretty much the first ones to popularize it in ham radio. And so we've been kind of SDR pioneers. But the problem with being an SDR pioneer is you all can, always can tell the pioneers are because they have the arrows in their back and they're lying face down in the dirt. Now, why is that? Why do the pioneers end up there, the first movers? Well, I'm going to talk a little bit about that and how you avoid ending up face down in the dirt, although I've been in the dirt a few times, too, over the last few years. Andy Grove, one of the Intel founders, I believe he was a founder, wrote a book called Only the Paranoid Survive, and he talks about inflection points. We all have inflection points. We have inflection points in our own personal lives, and I can think back to specific events that have happened in my life that changed everything. If you go back to that point and you say everything changed at that point, one of those was moving to Austin, Texas. One of those was meeting my wife, Virginia, up here. So those are inflection points in life, but business has inflection points as well. So let's see here. And those inflection points are points in time where the business has gotten to a certain point and things change. Things may change in the marketplace, the competition, all kind of, the technology can change, people change, all those things change. And you have a choice at those points. You can either die slowly as the business declines. You can make some very tough decisions, and those tough decisions have high risk associated with them, which means you could die very quickly, or the business could grow. So I'm going to talk about some of those inflection points. And sorry, I need a little bit of a cheat sheet here. How many of you have heard of Hernando Cortez? A few of you? Well, he, in 1519, went to what is now Mexico, and it was inhabited by the Mayan Empire, a very mighty, mighty empire. And he had only 600 people on his ships. And so when they went on land, he is said to have burned the boats. And so what that means is that he had a vastly outnumbered force that had landed, and that outnumbered force was able to take over the entire Mayan Empire because there was no turning back. They were 100% in, 100% committed. So that's what it takes oftentimes in business. In fact, this is something one of our advisors, Mac McCormick, said the other day. If you think you can, or if you think you can't, you're right. If you think you can, or you think you can't, you are right. Think about that for a moment. It has to do with being all in and all committed. So now to the story. That's me over on the right. I want to talk a little bit. I want to take you back in time. How many of you can remember when you discovered ham radio? You can remember it, can't you? If you think for just a minute, you probably have some emotion tied to it. It was magic. For me, it was magic. Guess what? It's still magic to me. That you can stick a wire in the air and you can send some electrons down that wire and talk to somebody on the other end of the world that has a wire. That's pretty amazing. That's more amazing than my cell phone. It really is to me, for some reason. It's still fun. So for all of us, it came with a discovery. We discovered radio in some way. Now I'm going to show you a bunch of cigar boxes. And that, if those cigar boxes didn't exist, I wouldn't be standing here tonight. Let me tell you why. somebody, I can't remember who, I was. I would guess it was somewhere around 1965, and when you see the little inflection thing over there, that's there for a reason. It says, this was an inflection point in my life, or in the business. So that's the symbol you'll see. The inflection point was somebody gave me a World War II transceiver. I have no idea what it was. And I was a kid at home. I didn't know what it was, but those parts were just fascinating, every part in it. So I took a pair of pliers and I'd twist the, I didn't have diagonal cutters back then, I just had a pair of pliers. I'd twist the wires and pull them apart. I pulled everything out of that radio, and I went to the drugstore and got all these cigar boxes, and I sorted them. And then I got some catalogs so I could figure out what the parts were, and I could put names on them. You know, old Allied catalogs? I see a lot of heads nodding, know what those are, right? And that's how I learned what they were. And then I met a friend at school who introduced me to ham radio, and he had a Hammerlin receiver. Remember those? Wow, they were nice, you know? So I got into ham radio. I'm not going to give you the whole story there because I got a lot more years to go through. That was 40 years ago. Then guess what? Life happens. I played ham radio. I got into engineering school, got a degree, and then met this young woman over here, and we had a life together. We had kids, three kids, and cats, no dogs, but life happened. So I got out of ham radio for probably 30, 35 years, something like that. Probably, did many of you do that too? You kind of dropped out, you know, for a while. You know what I'm talking about. Yeah. But then the story continues with rediscovery. Along the way, something happened. I went to, my son was, I think, 12 or 13. I was trying to commiserate with him this week to remember this. Does that sound about right? 12 or 13? I think it was around 97. We went to the Austin. Now, this picture I stole is not the real one, but yeah, that's not Anderson. Went down to Anderson High School. Some of these guys know what I'm talking about. Took my son Matt down there, and he just to show him what it was all about. But I wasn't active in ham radio. I still had my license, but wasn't active. And he said, "You know, Dad, I think I'd like to get my license." Wow, really? That was pretty cool because I never asked him to. He just said, "I'd like to do that. So would you study with me?" So I studied with Matt, and he got his license. I can't remember his call. It was a WN call, and he still has his WN call. He got his five-word minute license. But anyway, it got me back into radio. I bought a Yaesu FT-847, which I still have. And guess what? About that time, PSK-31, this was 1999, came out in December of 98, and so I started playing with PSK-31. And in engineering school, I had had a communications course. I was interested in RF communications. I remembered something about I and Q, in phase, and quadrature. And I remembered fast Fourier transforms. Now, I hadn't done engineering in 35 years, by the way. I'm doing business side of things and raising money and things like that. So I said, you know, I remember some theory, and I bet I could build a radio if I had a PC and a sound card. I could take I and Q and a lot of work and turn it into a radio. That's where it all started, and that was an inflection point. That was in 1999. Well, I actually put a prototype together of something. In fact, I actually have right here all of the prototypes. I brought them with you if you want to see them. And I have all of these prototypes in the box here, and I even have serial number one that was the guy who came to pick it up from my house sold it back to me. So I do have serial number one if you'd like to see it. And then there's serial number two. Actually, these prototype number two and prototype number three is right there. You can see it gets a little bigger each time. And then this is what the production unit looked like of the SDR 1000. There's a little, how many of you actually owned one of these at one point in this room? Several of you in here. In fact, if it weren't for TAPR, TAPR was an inflection point because in 2002, Steve, right, you called me, and he had read some articles that I'll talk about and invited me to come talk to the DCC conference that year. And it wasn't a business at that time, and I'll kind of bring that up in just a minute, but that was kind of a starting point. And I put some software together. I'd had a 1 hour course in Fortran in college, and I'd done a little bit of assembly language and micro fourth coding back in the mid 70s, and nothing since then. So I figured maybe I could learn VB6. So I picked up VB6 manual and started coding away, and got the Intel signal processing library and built that in, some DirectX sound stuff. And I was just grunting it out, trying to learn how to do this. And that's actually SDR console, where I find that it's interesting what you can find on the internet. That's where I went to get it. I had to go find it on the internet, what I'd done many years ago. And so this is another inflection point. It was so hard for me to dig it out. I hadn't touched math in 35 years. And I don't remember anything that I learned in math, come to think. I remember the names. I went to calculus, I'm sure, you know. But that was a long time ago. And I'd done about 2 years of engineering in my career. And so it was really hard. I'm not a mathematician. I'm intuitive, but not a mathematician. So I had to just kind of intuit how to do all this stuff. And so it was hard enough that I said, man, I'd like to make this easier for somebody else. So I wrote some articles for QEX, and they published it. And starting in July, August of 2002, the first three articles were written while it was a hobby. The fourth article was published after about the time it became a business. And I'll talk about that as inflection points here. So anybody remember the dot-com boom? So see 1999 there? My hobby started right there. Well, watch this slide. Boom. So let me talk a little bit about So I spent most of my career in high-tech companies. Well, and I had started several and helped to start some other ones. And if you're a CEO of a high-tech company, you spend 50% of your time raising money. Just a fact. About half your time, you're raising money. About another quarter of your time, you're managing the investors, and maybe the other quarter, you get to talk to customers. So I spent a lot of time doing that. I was involved in the whole internet boom here in Austin during that time in a company, and I invested money in some companies. And then one of the companies that helped get funded, invested money in, was Six Market, which was an artificial intelligence trading, hedge fund. Well, guess what happened about right there? About the time I got in was that peak right there. So we all know what happened after that. So I was playing around with this hobby at the time, and the businesses that I were in were going like this. And I said, I bet it's going to be hard to raise more money. That's what I've been always doing. The venture capital completely dried up 100% in this town. I'm sure it did pretty much in Silicon Valley, too. You guys can speak to that. But I'm sitting there in 02 with nothing to do, and I've been doing this hobby, and I said, well, I've started businesses all my career. Might as well start another one. Nobody's going to invest in it. It's ham radio. Nobody's investing in anything anyway. I'll just bootstrap it. So right there in late 2002, I come to Tapper and talk to the folks, and I said, anybody be interested in this? And I had some people nod their heads, said they would. And so I had hundreds of emails written to me all over the world about those articles. And I said, I got an email list. I've got some hardware here. I think I'll build 10 of those three board sets that you saw. And I'm going to send out an email to these folks and say, I'm building 10 units. And I'm only want to sell 10 units because I know what it's like to support stuff. Because I've been in the business, and I don't want to, you have to tell me what your resume is, because I want to know you're smart enough to use it and not give me a lot of trouble, and why you ought to get one of these 10. Well, I got 50 orders immediately with that first week, got 500 orders the first year. That was started shipping in March or April, somewhere in there, and 500 orders. Said, well, maybe there's a business here. But it's not a big one. And I can tell you, ham radio as a whole is not a big business, because one of the businesses I had run before is bigger than the entire ham radio market worldwide. So it's not a big business. And that wasn't a big business. So it's not a huge business, but I said, well, I'll try to bootstrap it. Everybody know what bootstrapping is? You know what I mean by bootstrapping? You pull it up, you do it with revenue, you do it with margin, and you grow the business just like this. Well, that brings with it a lot of challenges along the way too. But anyway, I started, if you look at the bottom of the trough, that's where I started. So let's talk about, hey family, let's burn the ships. I'm talking to my wife and my kids. I got two kids going into college at that time, one getting married. And so this is all at that time. And those businesses that had done this, they take the money with them that you invested in them. So this is kind of an interesting time. And you notice it says, okay, here we go again. That's my wife saying, okay, because I've done this before. So we start off, and here's the business in the house. I wish we could turn the lights down a little bit. You can't see that very well, can you? Can we turn the lights down to here? Oh, that looks too high tech. Oh, that's getting better, yeah. Yeah. So this is actually the beginning. Oh. All right, that's better. So this was my office / ham shack at the house. So we set up shop there and built in, you know, around the corner and everything there so that we could start designing. And that's me actually doing smart SDR console was the original VB6 version of the software. And here we see, unfortunately, I don't have many pictures with people in them. That I hate that. I couldn't find them. But I'll just have to tell you, you notice over on the right, SDR console was being developed here. Power SDR was being developed. And you see the credit card machine, and then you see Eric's letter jacket. Now, let me tell you about Eric. So Eric is my son-in-law. He had just been married for about a year, I think. And he finished up at University of Texas in computer engineering at the bottom of that trough. Well, there weren't many job interviews at the bottom of that trough around here. And I was killing myself. I was doing software, hardware, putting parts together, you know, testing boards, building websites, taking orders, emailing, doing support, and this was killing me. And I said, Eric, you know how to code. You want to come do some coding, but you're my son-in-law, and this may not work out. Let's give it 5-6 months, and we'll do a get-together and see if it's working out. Because I don't want to end up with a mess, you know, in the family. Well, Eric's still there here today. That's been 10 years, I guess. He actually interned the summer of 03, and I taught him how to solder boards on the kitchen table. So that's Eric, KE5DTO. Now, next slide, you'll see Joe Walsh called here one day of the Eagles. And I answer the phone, and he says, this is Joe Walsh, because he had bought an SDR-1000. And he later bought a 5000. I said, Joe Walsh, oh my goodness. Eric, you talk to him, because he wanted support. I just thought that was kind of fun. And this is Charlie, K5CAT. He was a volunteer open source developer. Literally, he has code in PowerSDR. He would walk across the keyboard periodically, and while Eric was working, he really likes to lay on your keyboard, as Virginia knows over here. And then there was another inflection point. There was a guy who wrote a letter to the editor of QEX about my articles, and he really didn't like the way I'd done it. You know who it is. Some of you guys know who it is. He was complaining about the fact that I used the Intel signal processing library instead of writing my own DSP. Now, I was doing everything I could to learn how to do this. I sure didn't need to go write a signal processing line. But that guy was this guy. Some of you guys know him. So he would call up, and the phone would ring, and Virginia would get it sometimes too. He'd say, this is Bob. Hi, this is Bob. And I'd say, Bob who? He wouldn't introduce. I didn't know who Bob was at the time. He would just call up and say, this is Bob. Some of these guys know him over here. And so over time, Bob and I became very good friends, and he volunteered to come help do DSP code for us. And Bob would come down and stay at our house. And shoot, Bob's got slippers somewhere under the bed, I think, you know. He's been there some. We were trying to figure out how many weeks he stayed at our house. It's in the months that he came to our house. Do you have any idea? It's a lot. But anyway, Bob became one of those people that not only was a tremendous help as a business, but he became a true friend. So we've been through a lot of stuff together, and he actually got his employer to fund open source development on DTTSP, and he worked for a three-letter kind of agency, some of y'all probably know. And he got that funded by the U.S. government, and he and Eric would IM all day long. He's at his office and working on DTTSP and integrating it with PowerSDR. That was happening in 04, 05, maybe 06. And later on, so this guy's been a huge help to us through the years, and he was going to be here this week, but his new employment didn't let him come this week. So to go a little bit forward, we actually, the first, 2003, I had a little bitty spot in the TAPR booth with a little easel, and I was selling the little three-board stack. By the way, the three-board stack with the wires, you had to be careful. You trip over it and it would fall off the desk. You had to be. So we started bringing home a little bacon. This is what you'd come home from Dayton with. And there are some hundreds in there. It's really funny to see how people walk up and will plunk down $1,000, $2,000. We've seen more than that at times. And then the SDR-1000 started to expand a little bit. You see over on the left, the three-board stack has now become a five-board stack, or a Dagwood sandwich, if you want to call it that. And we added a case because everybody wanted to put it in a case for some reason. And then we added a power amplifier with an ATU on top. That was an OEM ATU, but we built the power amplifier. Had a lot of help from some local folks around here. Mike Penley and Ken Simmons helped me a lot in those early days. But then we kind of ran into some roadblocks. We were always dealing with sound cards and their drivers, and you know, everybody wanted to know. We have still people asking us what kind of sound card we need. That's the weirdest thing. We hadn't dealt with sound cards since 2007. So, and if you look over to the right, you see all the wires. They got sound cards in the black box there on the right. It's wires, wires, and more wires. That was the SDR-1000 because you had sound cards and all this loop. Well, guess what happens when you loop audio cables around in a high RF environment? Yeah, a lot of stuff happens. And then, believe it or not, we were running out of customers. Does that sound weird? Why is that? Any of you ever heard of crossing the chasm? Yeah, some of you have heard it. It's very true. There are people on the, see over there on the left, it says technology enthusiast and early adopters over there on the left. Those are the people in this room, you guys. If some of you will buy whatever comes out just because it's interesting, right? Any of you ever done that? Yeah. It's interesting, so you'll buy it. It may not ever get used. It may just sit over in the corner. You got any kits you hadn't built? Any TAPR kits you hadn't built? Yeah, we all do, don't we? And then the people that follow that are the people that they're not quite like that, but they like the newest, coolest thing, and they're going to jump on board soon. Well, guess what? Over on the other side of what you see is the chasm there are what are called pragmatists. They just want it to work. They want to get on, push the button, and it works some DX, right? Very different mindset. The mindsets of the people on the left are totally different from the people on the right. What the people over here want are not what these people want, and vice versa. So that's why there's a chasm here, and many companies fall in the chasm, because when you go to the other side of the chasm, you're going to make the people mad that we're on this side of the chasm, because they don't like what you're doing over here, right? They just don't match. And so it's very hard to cross that chasm because everybody gets mad at you that have been your friends for so long. Well, hey, Eric, let's burn the ships. Eric's my only employee. No, actually, we had a couple of other employees. This was fun. We're at the house, and so the kids come home from college, and they're kitting parts. They're counting screws and resistors and all these kind of things. Tapper's never done that, right? You know that business model, don't you? Yeah, you're kitting parts. That's the way we did it. It was sold as a kit early on. Probably would never have passed CE in those days. So we kept it a kit in those days. And so the kids would work, and we had somebody come in to do shipping. We had a guy, Ed Pop, who comes in at 7:30. He comes and puts his food in the refrigerator for lunch at 11:59. He would turn around to Eric and he'd say, "I think I'll go feed my face." Every day, "I think I'll go feed my face." Ed is still with us. He does our service. He works in our service department. Interesting things that happen. UPS truck pulling up, FedEx truck pulling up, all those kind of things. So we set off and the Flex 5000 is born. This is actually a picture of a customer's birthday cake that his wife made for him. Now, do you think we have customers that like our radio? That's a true story. We do have our customers are called flexers for a reason. They do tend to be fanatical sometimes. So the 5000, that actually happened a little later than the design, but here's actually the design of the 5000. You can see the CAD layout there in the lab, and there's the first prototype coming together of the 5000. And here's a typical work week. Let's see, we got to get 6-meter power working. That was very hard to do. Let's see, we had MIDI control, all these kind of things up there. That was a typical week of things that we had to do. There's a lot on that list if you do a little bit of looking. That's just me and Eric and Bob. So this is true. That's a 1-gallon jug that says hook 'em horns on it or get it. And Eric can drink more than one of those a day, believe it or not. And that's smart SDR coming together on the console there. Now, the Flex 5000 leaked, and guess what happened to the SDR 1000 sales? See an inflection point here? So we start showing our baby. Now, we've got hardware, and it's not all working perfectly yet, and we got to get it. Getting it through CE was very difficult. I didn't know much about how to do that at the time, and it took a while to do it. But I think this was actually at Visalia that year at the DX conference. But over time, PowerSDR evolved and became kind of the standard for DSP, or software-defined radios over time. And we evolved from the 5000 in 2007 to the 3000 in 2009 and the 1500 in 2010. Where's Graham? Graham's back here. Graham came and joined us to design the 1500. He was retired and saw him at the Austin Handfest and invited him to come help design the 1500. So that's how he joined in with us, and you heard him talking about the API, the new Wave API today. So let's talk about the next inflection point. Hey, Steve, let's take on a government contract. Steve's over here. Raise your hand. Steve talked to you today about the open API. We had actually, before I met Steve, that guy, Bob, worked for somewhere, and we were on a bid list for a government contract, which we won. And it actually included taking technology that was in the 5000, and I'll show you what it looked like in a little bit, and turning it into something else. But it had big honking FPGAs in it, the design did, and it had synchronous receivers and all kinds of things in it, and I didn't have the expertise in-house to go do this. And so I ran into Steve, N5AC, at the Central States VHF conference. We had met before, you told me, but I didn't know who you were until then. But I heard him talk. I said, this guy is smart, and he can talk. I heard him talk at that conference, and I said, I want to hire you. And he said, no, I've got a job. And he gave me somebody else to talk to. Well, later on, I said, Steve, I went back to him and said, I really do want you to come work with us. And I finally talked him into it. And Steve, would you agree learning ain't linear?
Yes.
So Steve had to go on a very steep learning curve along with the rest of us, but he put together some pretty cool stuff. He started working on the thing on the right? That's where you started. That was a 32-channel synchronous receiver. By synchronous, I mean all 32 receivers tune phase synchronously on the fly and stay synchronous. So you can do all kinds of cool things like time difference of arrival, direction finding, things like that with it. Those are QSD-based. You can think of it as 32 Flex 5000 receivers in a 7U chassis and pulling 100 watts, I think it's what, 125 watts, something like that, for the whole chassis. Streaming those channels, 200 kilohertz bandwidth channels out over IQ using Vita 49, if that sounds familiar. That's where we learned how to do that. So there's an FPGA in there controlling all these receivers streaming out over gigabit Ethernet. Then the same contract had the thing on the left over there, which was a PCI Express card. Actually, it wasn't originally to be that way. Then they changed their mind and said they wanted it on PCI Express. They originally wanted Ethernet out the back. And so that's a four PCI channels, 16 HF receivers streaming, I think it's 250 kilosamples per second out, and plus a wideband spectrum analyzer that looked for energy. And that's got a very big FPGA on it to do that. So those were on one contract, and basically the technology that was in those top two things what allowed us to do the Flex 6000 series. The knowledge and the intellectual property to do that was what taught us to do those things. Then later on, we won a second contract in 2011 for a 24-band L-band, 24-channel L-band receiver with 80 megahertz instantaneous bandwidth per receiver with four 10 gigabit Ethernet channels. Well, we also needed somebody to help us do this FPGA work. So Marco, hey, raise your hand, Marco. Marco joined us back there. He didn't get to talk to you today, but he's the guy that, you did all the FPGA work on that, right? Pretty much? Yeah. Those have got big honking. These are like 5,000, it's got a pair of $5,000 FPGAs, I think they are, something like that. Two of those. These are big honking. And they do get warm, don't they? Can you fill those four 10 gigabit each Ethernet channels? You can, right? So we learned a lot in doing this. So that was kind of the genesis of some things later. So you can see it's an inflection point. Now, you notice that chip right there, it says F3 on it. That actually was a hand-tested at AD, analog devices. We got it, maybe it actually was more than a year before it actually came out, but it fell off a truck on the way to another company here in Austin that remain unnamed. And so we got to be friends with the analog devices people, and they just liked us for some reason. And we had won this contract, and that was the only part that would really fit the specs that we needed. And so we got it very early, and that is the part that's in the Flex 6000 series. That's a very high-performance 250 megasample per second converter. So that was another inflection point. Now, things keep happening out there in the world, and so we're dealing with those drivers. And FireWire, which worked great, was getting hard to get. And PC latency was always an issue. You're trying to do CW, where you got a PC, you're back and forth to a PC and trying to do Morse code is the hardest modulation mode in amateur radio. It is. It seems like it's simple, but it's not. Because of the timing, it's so precise. So it's kind of hard. And then Power SDR evolved from my smart SDR, SDR console, and grew over the years, and we had people sticking code into it. Any of you ever written spaghetti code? You know what I mean by spaghetti code? It just evolves. And sometimes you just can't do anything about it except to pitch it. So, and then the state of the world has changed. At this point, we're starting to hear about the Internet of Things, aren't we? Everything's connected to the Internet. Ethernet is ubiquitous. Instead of worrying about drivers, how many times do you worry about an Ethernet driver? You just don't, do you? Yeah, occasionally, but it's so rare, you just plug it in and it works, right? Because the vendor can't sell a machine if the Ethernet driver doesn't work. Not true of some of the other drivers, some of the other sound card drivers that you have to deal with. And so the world was changing, so we got to do something again. Okay. And these things can be very unpopular. Hey guys, let's burn the ship again. Oh no! Now we got lots more mouths to feed. We've got all these people that have been doing the government contracts, and we've staffed up and everything, but we're going to go burn the ships again. Scary times, right, Steve? But Steve and I believed we could do it. We were like Cortez. We believed we could do it. And this was in 2011. In fact, I went back in my notes, and we were making decisions in about March of 2011. And so we did something that I don't think many companies do, that big companies or small companies, is say, we're going to start with a clean sheet of paper. That is really hard to do if you've ever been in a technology company. We're going to leave the entire, we're not going to take a line of code, not one, because it's open source. We can't. We're going to start from scratch. And we're going to take, even though we did a lot of stuff in the government contracts, it wasn't exactly what we needed. So we started with a clean sheet of paper. And we said, what should the architecture of the future look like? And we started drawing that architecture, the software and the hardware. And we started over. That was June of 2011. Believe it or not, May of 2012, we showed hardware with some cobbled together software. It was sort of, we were playing audio through it and demoing it. But that's the team that we took to Dayton. Remember that little booth back that I showed you a while ago? We had like 18 people, I think, manning the booth at the show, and we were totally slammed. We surprised everybody the week of Dayton and said, we're bringing a totally new kind of radio to Dayton. And we were totally swamped in a 600-foot booth, but we couldn't deliver it yet. The hardware was ready, but mostly ready, but the software had a lot of ways to go because PowerSDR had developed over many years, had lots of features, lots of feedback, but we had to start from scratch. So guess what happened to 5,000 sales? Sort of an inflection point there too. It actually, we expected it to happen, but not as, it actually lasted a little bit longer than we thought, but eventually you can't build them in enough volume to make it worthwhile, and so you have to quit. And so that's kind of what happened. So there was a lot of nail biting during this time. Steve said, why is this so complicated? Eric says, I think the thing that's changed is that we realize how complicated it is. Jim, who's unfortunately silent key now, on the Linux code driver, this is way deeper in the Linux kernel than I've ever been before. That's how we felt. Matt, on the sales forecast, it's not pessimism, it's correcting for our optimism. Looking at the bug list, Klaus, I can't see the bottom. Steve, that's the problem. Matt on the smart SDR, Matt is our CFO and GUI designer. every time you add a checkbox, an angel loses its wings. Ed, back here, after making an 11th hour code change, it's not real if you don't say it out loud. What were you doing, Ed? I like that one. And the error message of the day, glibc detected, firmware free, corrupted, unsorted chunks, aborted. That probably happened late at night too, didn't it? So, what's something that we've learned? If you think we're a hardware company, you're wrong. We deliver hardware to deliver the softwares. It's the software, stupid. That's what we've learned. You know, we have many more people working in software than we do in hardware. The hardware is easy, the software is hard. I can tell you that. And what have we learned about that? Well, you saw the spaghetti code that I talked about earlier. We don't want to have that again. And it takes guys like the ones that are here with us tonight to go build real software with discipline that has a vision of the future, way beyond. You know, the API things and the Wave API, these guys have been dreaming about that from early on and had that in their mind. Steve is the chief architect over here, and he's really the vision behind how that's coming together. And it's really cool to see it coming together. Sometimes at the last minute, that came to work about Thursday. The Codec 2 started working about Thursday, right? Oh, I wasn't supposed to say that. I'm sorry. That's the way it always happens. You got to have a deadline, you know? If you don't have a deadline, you never do anything. So let me talk about what that means. In the early days of PowerSDR, we would have an idea and we'd code it, right? You just idea code. Well, that's how you get spaghetti code. Some customers say, I gotta have this. So you go code it. Well, you end up with this mess. Well, that can happen very quickly, can't it? You can go from idea to code very quickly, and sometimes people say, why can't you go quicker? Well, you can go quicker, but you end up messed up in the long run. You end up with that spaghetti code. So what does it take to do real software? It takes a roadmap. You got to know where you're going. You got to have, we use agile development, which is a development methodology. We have processes. We review those processes. Every time we do a software release, they come back and do an after-action review and say, what went well? What went poorly? How do we change our processes? You have just implemented just-in-time design. They used to do design on the front end of a release cycle, and then by the time you code it, you've forgotten what you did. And now they use just-in-time design. They design it, code it. Design it, code it. So much, much more efficient. We use time-box deadlines. What that means is when you see the roadmap, you can pretty well count on the date of that release. What does that do? It forces a different kind of discipline. It forces you to plan so that you're not planning your entire resources equal to the entire resource cycle, because people take vacations, they get sick, things don't work when you think they're supposed to work, so you have to do those kind of things. We scrum every day. That means at 9 o'clock, everybody, it used to be just the software people, but our entire company's in the scrum now. We can do an entire company scrum in 10 to 15 minutes. And it's really amazing what that does for us in knowing what's going on in the company. We implemented static analysis tools, automated builds, GitHub repositories, which some of you will be using, and APIs. All of those things are things that have come into place by changing from a hardware company mentality to a software company mentality. Well, and there's what the roadmap looks like. I took an old copy and added shipped. We're up through 1.3. Each cycle is about 3 months on that calendar. So we're well into the 1.4, and we generally have something that we haven't planned, like the Codec 2 implementation, the Wave API is not in the roadmap. We generally throw something in if we can. That's kind of fun, Easter eggs. So this is what Smart SDR looks like with one of the 8 PAN adapters brought up. And you can see the 6,000 family, the 6,700, 6,500, and the 6,300 over there. But there was another inflection point last year, last August. We had the 6,700, 6,500, so we didn't really have a model that kind of replaced the price point of the Flex 5000. And so we said, we really need to design and ship a 6,300, which is in the $2,500 price clip class, by Dayton. We want to put it on the truck and be ready to go by Dayton. That's August. Dayton is May of the next year. You realize how short that is, hardware and software. So we said, help. That was kind of how we felt at that time. But we felt like we could do it because we had learned so much at that point, and SmartSDR was getting well along in its maturing cycle. So guess what? May 2014, we announced it. Greg, we're out of stock. What? We sold out our entire three-month production run in 10 days from the time we announced it. So that was kind of this is our first time to ever announce and ship on the same day. That really is not very usual in our market either, in the ham radio market. But we felt it was really important to do that all at once and be able to ship at the same time. So, gosh, I can't believe it. It's 45 minutes and I'm on track here. Let me kind of summarize. So what were the inflection points along the way? The dot-com bust was a personal inflection point for me. We crossed the chasm, which was going from the 1,000 to the 5,000. And sometimes we feel like we're sliding back off of it. The government contracts were a big thing. We started over. And by the way, when we started over with the 6,000, we passed back over the chasm. We went back over it because we were starting so with such a little code base in our software, we kind of had to go back and come back, and we've come back. And then I threw on there the open API. That may be an inflection point. I can't predict it, but you guys heard it for the first time today. That lets lots of people do cool things with radios in a way that's never been. You can experiment on a radio that's across the chasm. That's kind of bridging the chasm in a way. We're hoping that allows experimenters to have fun. At the same time, a contest station can sit down and use it. You know, those are the two worlds that we're trying to bridge, or a DXer can bridge both worlds. So, what's next? Who knows? I can't predict it. But I'm sure there's another inflection point out there somewhere. So thank you very much for your attention. I really appreciate it. Anybody have any questions you'd like to ask? I can probably.
Is that the same gallon container Eric still has?
I think it's actually been replaced. That one wore out. Yes?
Okay. You said you bootstrapped. Did you bootstrap up to this point, and are you looking for investors or going public?
Okay. That's a good question. We have bootstrapped to this point. In my career, I spent much of my career raising money, and I said, I don't want to do that anymore. I've had all kinds of investors, public, private, angels, VCs, the whole thing. It's not any fun, just to be honest with you. So I look at it as our investors are our customers. You know, they're the people, they're our stakeholders, the ones that pay the bills, and so it keeps us focused on our customers. So.
Are you gonna run out of customers?
Well, we have tapped only a percentage of the amateur marketplace. We're hoping to grow that market share substantially. There's room for growth because we've got disruptive technology. What's out there is legacy kind of systems, multi-conversion systems, boxes, and so forth. So we think that there's a lot of room for growth for SDRs as we expand the capabilities of these radios. So.
What's the average age?
45 to 65 or so, the baby boomers. You know, that's most of the people coming into our hobby are coming in, they're post-kids. You know, kids are out of school. They've got discretionary money and time on their hands. That's the typical buyer of our radios. Interesting thing is that I guess the old knobs versus no knobs is one of the arguments that always goes on, and there are arguments for both. If you're certain kinds of operation, a knob or two, can be really helpful, but other kinds of operation, it doesn't make any difference. So that's one of the debates that's ongoing, I would say. I will say that I think things are going our way because as people come in their 55 age range, how many of you did not have, I think about it, I've been using a computer since the 70s, right? Most of you have? So most of people in their 60s, which is where I am, have been using computers a long time and are very comfortable with it. Our parents were not, right? So I'm of the opinion that more and more people are comfortable using computers that are coming into the ham radio stage of life. Life happens. You don't play ham radio while life is happening, but you get through that period, then you got a little time, you got extra money, and that's where people are coming into the hobby. And I hope that's where we keep getting that. I wish we got more young people like I was in it, but I don't think they do. They're too busy on playing with their computers and, Facebook. Any other questions? Yeah.
On the software side, how long are your agile durations?
2 weeks.
2 weeks is what he said.
I'm an undergrad at UT Dallas. How could I possibly use your products to draw more people into the hobby? How can I make it appeal to the CS majors?
That is a good question. I would bet this API is a great way to do it. One of the things, too, is if you sit down and look at the spectrum, what we find, if you take one of our radios to field day and you have young people come, where are they going to gravitate? They're going to come to our radios and not the knob radios, right? So that's number one, being able to visually see the signals. Number two, I think, tying them into being able to program and actually do signal processing and control the radios, I think that'd be a great way. Steve, you have anything? You agree with that? Yeah. Yes?
Matt, not actually too familiar with your product. Was never an HF ham previously. Just started getting into it a bit. Do you have any plans to, when you need the software, obviously, to make this work, do you have anything other than Windows support for this?
There's currently iOS support on the iPad. One of the things on the API is that third-party developers can actually do that. So Steve mentioned that this in his talk. K6TU took our API in, what was it, in how many weeks? 6 weeks. He had a full iPad app running. Now, he doesn't have the pan adapter, but a full 100% of the control. We have, 35 or so developers before today signed up? 40 developers signed up before today. I know at least a couple of those are working on Linux, right? Have said so, and maybe an OS X application. It takes a tremendous amount of effort to support a single GUI, and all the work that goes into that, a single GUI. So we have all of our efforts into Windows because that is 90-something percent of the population. But we're hopeful that other people... Now, Stu's iOS, what's the interface, the API for, what is that called that's run? Objective-C can be ported to the Mac. And so if anybody's interested in working on that, I'm sure he'd be happy to work with you. Is he working on that, or is he not going to do that? I don't know. But we'd be glad for any of you guys that want to do a Linux or a Mac, especially Mac, to hop on board and do it. I don't see us having the near-term resources to do that. Just
what are the chances that you would like to essentially connect your API to new radio or something like that?
Didn't somebody say they'd done it here today?
No. I asked you.
Oh, you had. I thought somebody else said they had done it, said it here locally, a local ham.
It was LabVIEW or one of the...
MATLAB.
No. It was MATLAB, wasn't it? Oh, that's right. I mistook it. He'd done it with MATLAB. Ed has done GNU radio before. It wouldn't be hard, would it?
A couple weeks.
A couple weeks. Yeah, so if somebody wanted to take that one on, that would be a good thing to do. I don't see us doing it short term, but you know, that it's not would not be difficult to do it. Ed did it on that. You did it on the 24 channel unit, didn't you? Ed, was that the 24 channel L-band receiver you did it on? So he's done it on one of our receivers before, but it's just work. Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Gerald. And what we would like to do is for one of your inflection points that you might be able to put this nice plaque on your wall saying Gerald Youngblood K5SDR for being our keynote speaker at the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference.